Okay, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Nioni, ID fellow. We will talk about urinary tract infections, and this is an update mostly in diagnosis and treatment. Probably you know already pathophysiology, etiology, so it's more about management. So this is the outline. We will talk a little bit about the IDSA guidelines. We have three guidelines that apply to urinary tract infection. Brief introduction. One of the guidelines is about acute uncomplicated cystitis and pyelonephritis in non-pregnant women. Acute complicated cystitis and pyelonephritis, complicated and non-complicated. UTI in men, UTIs in pregnancy. And this topic is catheter-associated asymptomatic bacteria and catheter-associated UTIs, mostly in the nursing home patients or the patients in the hospital. And diagnosis and treatment of asymptomatic bacteria. So there are three different guidelines that apply to these topics. So these are the guidelines. The first, about uncomplicated cystitis and pyelonephritis, is an update of the guidelines in 1999, and this update was in 2010. The guideline for catheter-associated urinary tract infections was made in 2009. This is the last guideline. And then regarding asymptomatic bacteria, we have guidelines in 2005. And we don't have any recent updates. So, a brief introduction. All these guidelines, especially the one that referred regarding urinary tract infection, the lower tract, cystitis, and uncomplicated pyelonephritis, the recommendations takes into the most important thing in these guidelines is the concept of collateral damage and antimicrobial resistance. To take decision which antimicrobial to recommend. So these are the two principal points. Regarding collateral damage, what is collateral damage? This, in the right you have here a definition. Is the ecological adverse effects of antimicrobial therapy such as the selection of MDRO, multidrug resistant organism, or colonization. And the concept is, for example, you can treat, if you have an uncomplicated cystitis, of course, you can use imipenem or ertapenem, but the collateral damage will be really, really huge. And it's going to be effective, of course, but the collateral damage regarding selection of multidrug resistant organisms is going to be very important. And collateral damage usually we see with cephalosporins, especially third generation, and fluoroquinolones. Regarding cephalosporins, third generation cephalosporin, we can see here in the hospital a lot of patients with ESBL producing strains, and this is mainly due to the use of broad-spectrum cephalosporins. And of course, we have to take into account the antimicrobial resistance, and it's impossible for the guidelines to make a universal recommendation all over the world. So it's important the local patterns of resistance. And there is some breakpoints to have in consideration when we start therapy. For example, we know that worldwide, the resistance of E. coli, that is the most common pathogen that you already probably know, to ampicillin is more than 20%, so we should not start a patient on ampicillin, for example. And there is a clear trend of increased resistance to quinolones also in E. coli, that is different in different parts of the world and even within the United States, and even within Louisville, Kentucky, for example. It's not the same, the E. coli that we have in our population, that probably the population that goes to St. Mary's Elizabeth. So it's changing all the time. And the local patterns of resistance is very important. We'll talk a little about that here at UofL. And there is some cutoff or breakpoints about resistance we should that preclude the use of some antibiotics. For example, for Bactrim, in E. coli, we should not use Bactrim if the resistance in the community is more than 20%. And this is expert opinion, it's not that. It's based in mathematical models and expert opinion. And for quinolones, the breakpoint is 10%. So we should know in our community what is the percentage of resistance to these two groups of drugs. Regarding this is the guideline from 2010, and the first guideline was in 1999. So there were some updates. And we know that for uncomplicated cystitis, the signs and symptoms, for example, urgency, burning, the positive predictive value of these symptoms in a young woman, they are so important that they are so high that we don't need to order urine cultures, for example, for uncomplicated cystitis. So when we should order urine cultures and lower urinary tract infections? Of course, the symptoms are not characteristic of UTI. See, the symptom persists or recur more than within 3 months of following treatment. If you suspect there is an obstruction, that by definition obstruction is complication, in this case you should order, or you suspect pyelonephritis, patient with burning, urgency, but has also back pain, some little back pain or chills, subjective fevers, in this case you should order urine cultures. And these are the cutoff or the breakpoints to say that this is changing all the time. But more or less is 10 to the 3rd and 10 to the 5th is the cutoff to say the patient has urinary tract infection. And of course, there is some variation between men and women. For men with 10 to the 4th is enough to say that the patient has a urinary tract infection, in addition to symptoms, of course, signs of symptoms. And a woman with uncomplicated UTI, you can take like positive 10 to the 3rd. And some chances it's not reported a real UTI, but with 10 to the 3rd, you can report like UTI, in addition to symptoms, of course. So these are the recommendations regarding antimicrobial therapy for acute uncomplicated cystitis. And the best drug that is worldwide recommended right now in this moment due to the high rate of resistance to quinolones and to Bactrim is nitrofurantoin. It's 100 milligram Q12, 5 days. And since the last guidelines in 1999, there were 4 randomized controlled trials that show that nitrofurantoin is equivalent to 3 days of Bactrim, for example, for lower UTIs and complicated, of course. And you can see that the clinical cure rates are very high, 88, 93%, and the bacterial cure rate is also high, more than 90%. And then they did a meta-analysis demonstrating that it's equivalent with 3 days of Bactrim. And what happened with this drug, of course? The drug resistance in the community is minimal, and the propensity to produce collateral damage is almost, it doesn't exist. So it's an optimal drug to treat cystitis in the outpatient care, in the ERs. And the resistance testing at UofL in the outpatient's urine culture is 1%. So for you, you can realize that the resistance to nitrofurantoin is really, really low. There is some contraindication, for example, patient with renal failure, creatinine clearance less than 60, we should not use nitrofurantoin. And here it says okay with ESBL, because most of the ESBL that you see in the hospital in the patient that have these enterobacters, E. coli, ESBLs, they are still sensitive to nitrofurantoin. And
we are seeing more and more patients with ESBL from the community, because the patients were hospitalized one more before, or were in nursing homes, or were doing wound care at home, and they are colonized with multi-drug resistant organisms. So it's not uncommon to see old patients with ESBLs, and this would be a really good option. Regarding Bactrim, the resistance to Bactrim in our old patients is 24%, and this surveillance was like 312 patients in 2012, and the resistance rate is 24%. It's really high, so we should not use in our old patients urinary tract infections Bactrim. But this still is a recommendation A1 in the guidelines, and the dose, of course, is double strength, twice a day for 3 days. Of course, like we said before, the breakpoint is 20% is expert opinion. But if we take the guidelines like standard of care, we should not use empirically. Unless, of course, we have urine culture that is sensitive to Bactrim, but in lower urinary tract infection, we don't have urine culture. And since the last guidelines in 1999, we had 4 randomized controlled trials that demonstrate non-inferiority, because most of the tests, the trials now, are to show non-inferiority when you compare with other drugs. And it showed that Bactrim has non-inferiority compared to 3 days course with quinolones or 5 days on nitrofurantoin. So it became like a recommendation A1, but we know that here we should not use it.
Of course, the early clinical and microbiological cure rates are in the 90-100% range. And regarding collateral damage, it's not as important as the fluoroquinolones or the cephalosporin, but still, it's more dangerous than the nitrofurantoin. But the important point is that resistance at UOL is 24% for Bactrim, so it's really high. And if we have to define, we want to start Bactrim because we don't have another choice, and we want to know what are the risk factors for TMS resistance. Well, the previous use of Bactrim, for whatever reason, can be skin and soft tissue infection, or a previous UTI during the past 3 to 6 months, it precludes its use. Our travel, international travel with to a region that is showing high resistance, more than 20%, we should not use it. Then there is a drug that has not been widely used here in the United States, but has been widely used for years in Europe, that is called fofomycin trimethanol. And the drug resistance is really minimal with this drug, and the propensity to produce collateral damage is almost doesn't exist. And we can use it in a single dose. There is new data since the last guideline in 1999. There is a couple of studies that is showing that it can be selected like first light agent. But in some trials showed a lower bacterial efficacy compared to first line, but the clinical efficacy is about the same. It's of course first line in the European guidelines, but not here. Now in the new guidelines we can choose it with in the guidelines in 2010. And the problem is that we don't do usually susceptibilities to fofomycin, but even the gram-negative rod ESBL-producing strains are sensitive. Even some Acinetobacter strain, KPC, you can see in some trials in or prospective studies or case reports in Europe that are sensitive to fofomycin. We don't have too much experience in the United States, and the breakpoint for sensitivity are not usually done, but it's an option to use. Regarding the quinolones, levofloxacin, ciprofloxacin, ofloxacin. Remember that sparfloxacin and gatifloxacin are no longer in the market. In a 3 days regimen, of course, it's effective, it's very effective, but the propensity to produce collateral damage is really high because of selection of multidrug resistant organisms, most important MRSA, and this is because of the effects in the fecal flora, in the vaginal flora. And regarding resistance, at UOL, here in our outpatient, the resistance to ciprofloxacin and levofloxacin is the same, is around 26%. So we are above the breakpoint that precludes the use of ciprofloxacin. So we should not use either empirically ciprofloxacin if we follow the local patterns of resistance. Of course, but it's very effective. When it works, it's very effective. So the excessive and unacceptable collateral damage is not acceptable to treat cystitis, acute uncomplicated cystitis, in addition to the resistance, of course. The beta-lactams. There is just one beta-lactam that is highly recommended for urinary tract infection, that is called bimesilinium, that is not available in the United States. It has been extensively used in Europe. I didn't put it in the slide because we are not using it. But from the beta-lactam, of course, the most important is the collateral damage. Like we talked before when we started the lecture, the collateral damage and the origin of ESBL is very important. For example, with cefpodoxime, that is a broad-spectrum cephalosporin oral, twice daily is equivalent to TMS for 3 days, but the collateral damage is really, really important. And amoxicillin, we know that ampicillin and amoxicillin we should not use because the resistance is more than 20% worldwide. But amoxicillin clavulanic acid has been recommended as first light agent. But there's some trials in the last guideline that clearly failed compared to ciprofloxacin because we have lower eradication of the uropathogens. So the patient can become reinfected. It can work at the beginning, but then 2 weeks later, 3 weeks later, it can become reinfected. And it has lower efficacy related to persistence of vaginal reservoirs. This is why probably you can have more recurrence. But the most important point is the origin of ESBL. This is one of the most important. Like I said here, avoidance of beta-lactam like empiric therapy, other than pimecillina. And these are some of the beta-lactam that are recommended: cefpodoxin, cefnidil, cefaclor, amoxicillin, clavulanic acid, but not amoxicillin. The only case that you will use amoxicillin if you have Enterococcus fecalis, mostly, in the urine. So, in the event that some chances happen that the patient comes to the emergency department with burning, malaise, fatigue, some abdominal pain, subjective fever, you don't know really, the patient didn't measure the temperature, you are not very sure, prolonged duration of symptoms, more than 5 to 7 days of symptoms, back, flank pain, otherwise not explained, the white blood cells are in the limit, for example, 10,000, 11,000. So you know it's a lower urinary tract infection or an upper. Of course, you will order a urine culture in this case because you are considering to treat the worst scenario. And in this case, you cannot use nitrofurantoin or fofamycin if you are thinking in an upper, because the tissue penetration of these drugs are not very good. It's just for lower urinary tract infection, for cystitis. In this case, you will not choose nitrofurantoin and fofamycin. For acute pyelonephritis, and this again, these recommendations apply when the resistance to quinolones is less than 10%. We know that here we have 26%. Oral ciprofloxacin is the typical dose is 500 twice daily for 7 days. And what is new in the guidelines that they recommend, and it's recommendation sometimes A1 or A2 or B3, to recommend an initial one-time IV agent, like for example ceftriaxone, or a 24-hour dose of an aminoglycos, for example choramycin, gentamicin, just the first dose, and then you continue with the oral therapy. And this is for all patients, so it means that you give the IV dose in the emergency room for a couple of hours, and you send the patient on quinolones. Like we said before, this is if the resistance in the community is less than 10%, and there is the option to give the 1 gram extended release for 7 days also. To give levofloxacin, we can give 5 days for pyelonephritis, and this is a B2 recommendation. The microbiological success is 99 versus 89%, and 96 versus 83% in the clinical response compared to Bactrim. So it's higher than Bactrim for empiric treatment for pyelonephritis. And regarding Bactrim for treatment, we can only use Bactrim if we know that the organism is susceptible, and in this case, we will have urine culture because it's an upper urinary tract infection. The dose is 2 weeks instead of 7 days, and it's, of course, double strain. In this case, if the organism is not known, and you want to start the patient on Bactrim because you don't have any option, again, you can give an initial dose of ceftriaxone, toramycin, or gentamicin in the emergency room, and then you can switch to oral and weigh the cultures, of course, because in this case you will have urine cultures. Remember that there is no indication to do routine follow-up urine culture. We don't have to do the proof of cure for pyelonephritis. You just do the urine culture at the beginning, and you need to repeat it after treatment, unless you have a pregnant woman. That is a different topic. Remember, like we said before, if resistance in the community to quinolones is known to be more than 10%, we should not use quinolones, or if we choose to use it until we have the urine culture, we should do an IV agent again. And this is recommendation B2. It's not like it's randomized controlled trials. These are prospective studies. The level of evidence is not so high, but it's recommended by these guidelines. Of course, you have the choice. If you cannot do it IV, you can do it intramuscular, but it's not highly recommended because of the incidence of abscesses or hematomas. But this is a good option to start when you don't have very clear what organism can be, to use broad spectrum cephalosporin, but just 24 hours. Regarding acute pyelonephritis, the beta-lactam totally are less effective than all the other agents that we'll talk about. And of course, if you choose to use cefpodoxime or some of the cefuroxime, some of the oral cephalosporins, again, it's recommended an initial one-time agent like ceftriaxone or aminoglycos. And in this case, you will treat 2 weeks, from 10 to 14 days, compared to 5 days that you can treat with levofloxacin. But again, the beta-lactam are not highly recommended for urinary tract infections, unknown unless you know the organism is susceptible and you don't have any more options. Of course, ceftriaxone is totally different because you can give it IV. And of course, we were talking about outpatient therapy for pyelonephritis. Sometimes you cannot treat the patient like outpatient because the patient is severely ill, fever, is not able, is with vomiting, is not able to take pills. So you decide to admit the patient. Of course, you have more options again. Intravenous fluoroquinolone, ciprofloxacin, levofloxacin, aminoglycos. In this case, with or without ampicillin, if you have positive urine culture for enterococcus, you know you need a beta-lactam plus aminoglycos. Extended spectrum cephalosporin, third generation, fourth generation. Extended spectrum penicillins. And carbapenems, if you suspect that the patient can be colonized with ESBL, Enterobacter chloeci, E. coli, and the patient has urosepsis, is coming from a nursing home, you should start carbapenems. If you are thinking of Pseudomonas, nortapenem, meropenem, or imipenem. Of course, if the patient is bacteriemic, has bacteremia, it's going to be an intermittent bacteremia, not a continuous bacteremia. So you don't need to extend the duration of treatment due to positive blood culture. It's like pneumonia. If you have pneumonia with positive blood culture for pneumococcus, you will treat like the regular length of therapy because that's an increased mortality. And this is the case of complicated cystitis or pyelonephritis. And within years, the definition of complicating has been more and more causes of complicating. For example, even for lower urinary tract infection or upper urinary tract infection, these are more or less when we call complicated. Multidrug resistant organism, wherever you have obstruction, renal transplantation, any type of immune suppression, instrumentation, history of pyelonephritis, renal failure, pregnancy, diabetes, because with diabetes you have more risk for emphysematous and papillary necrosis, and hospital acquired or presence of catheter. When you have a patient with urinary tract infection with a catheter, intrauterine catheter, is complicated by definition. And you can see that here, I didn't write men. Traditional men was considered complicated. In the recent reviews, they say that it was called complicated because usually see urinary tract infection when the patient is less than 1 year, when the patient is more than 60 years because it has prostatic problems. So in these two cases, extremes of age, usually it's complicated because you have an obstruction, not because the sex itself. So it's not uncommon to have patients with uncomplicated cystitis, and they are men, 35, 40 years of age, and it's related with anal intercourse or lack of circumcision, and it's not related with any type of obstruction, and it's by definition not complicated. So traditionally for years has been take as complicated with men, and the length of therapy is not the same, but now there is a lot of, in the literature, a lot of discussion about if the sex itself is a criteria to consider it complicated or not, or is due to obstruction. Of course, in all the complicated, you should order urine culture and susceptibility testing. In the case of complicated cystitis, again, you have the dose of quinolones, and the same rule apply. Always the 10% breakpoint for resistant to quinolones, or the 1 gram once daily in extended release, or levofloxacin. And you can see the range that is recommended in the guidelines, from 5 to 15 days. So usually something in the middle, 10 days, is what we usually do, or 7 to 10 days, traditionally for men. And of course, you can use all the quinolones, but not moxifloxacin, because there is some concern with that is not very active in urine. Of course, it's all patient. And cephalosporin, carbapenems, aminoglycos, if the patient is admitted, because the patient can have a cystitis that is complicated with an obstruction, with renal stones, with a lot of pain, and the patient is admitted, probably you will start something IV. And again, in the acute complicated cystitis, you suspect that the kidney tissue, the tissue can be infected, not only the urinary tract. So you would not use nitrofurantoin, Bactrim, unless you know that it's susceptible, of course, the organism. Fofomycin or oral beta-lactams in these cases. If you know that the organism is susceptible, of course, you can use Bactrim. But you have to have the urine culture, and in this case you will have it because by definition you should order urine culture. Of course, acute complicated pyelonephritis is almost 100%, you have to admit the patient. And in this case you have to address the underlying cause of complication, obstruction, renal stones, immunodepression, neurogenic bladder. In this case, should be treated for 10 to 14 days. And of course, the patient doesn't respond during the first 72 hours. You have to be sure to rule out perinephric abscess, corticomedullary abscesses, papillary necrosis, and renal stones. And to begin with the screening for complications, CT scan is very sensitive and specific, especially for renal stones. UTI in men, like we said, traditionally was considered a complicated UTI, and now there is a lot of articles that are saying that the sex is itself is not a factor for complication. The recommended breakpoint for to consider urinary tract infection in men is a midstream urine culture is recommended to confirm with 10 to the 4 colonies. And of course, always obtain urine culture since traditionally was considered complicated, we should always still is recommended to obtain urine cultures in men. Even when there is some discussion about the complication concept. Always in men we should rule out uretritis, gonococcal, no gonococcal, chlamydia, and prostatitis, particularly if you have recurrent urinary tract infection in a man, you should rule out prostatitis, usually chronic bacterial prostatitis. For cystitis, the same rules apply regarding resistance. You have in the community more than 20% of resistance to Bactrim for E. coli, you should not use it empirically, but in this case you will have urine culture because you should order from the beginning. Again, Bactrim double strength twice daily, ciprofloxacin, 500 Q12 or the extended form release, or levofloxacin. And the same rule, like I said before, apply regarding risk factor for resistance. And for pyelonephritis, the same rules apply that for women. Of course, the most important concept here is always rule out prostatitis. It's not common to have urinary tract infection in men. Like I said before, sometimes now in this at this point, usually if you have urinary tract infection in men, you have to ask for sexual practices, especially anal intercourse or lack of circumcision. These are the two most common causes, unless the patient is 65 years old and has prostatic problems, of course. Regarding pregnancy, these are the agents that we should avoid. Bactrim, for example, is class C for the FDA for pregnancy. And usually we should avoid it in the first trimester and near term. And near term is because, of course, the first trimester because it's a folate antagonist and you can have neural tube defects. And near the term is because Bactrim can produce carnectarius because interacts with the indirect bilirubin and can produce carnectarius in the newborn. So usually you can use it in the second trimester, but no one is gonna take the risk to use Bactrim probably for pregnancy. Of course, you know that fluoroquinolone is totally contraindicated in pregnant women due to concerns from to bone in the cartilage and in the bone. Tetracycline, you know that is contraindicated also. Aminoglycos, you will not use aminoglycos unless it's totally necessary in a pregnant woman due to concern for ototoxicity and nephrotoxicity also. And imipenem, cilastatin, in the group of carbapenems, if you admit the patient and you decide to treat IV, there is some concerns with some trials, and it was placed in category C, not meropenem or ertapenem. What is recommended? Usually we can use amoxicillin, but only in the case, of course, not empirically, only in the case that we have enterococcus, usually enterococcus fecalis that is sensitive to ampicillin, amoxicillin clavulanic. Cefalexin is the traditional agent worldwide used for pregnant woman is usually has been widely used, but there's not a lot of evidence to recommend like class A1 for pregnant. Fofomycin, and this is the most recommended, nitrofurantoin, 5 days. Nitrofurantoin is class B regarding pregnancy and can be safely used unless the patient has renal insufficiency or other problems or allergy. And this is one beta-lactam cephalosporin oral that you can still use it, cefpodoxin. Of course, we have to take into account the collateral damage and the local patterns of antimicrobial resistance. This is why it's difficult for this guideline to make a universal recommendation worldwide. Usually, you treat for 3 to 7 days, and you have to do a test of cure, of course, in this patient, probably monthly until delivery, and just to test, because you know that pregnancy woman that has asymptomatic bacteriuria is one of the indications for treat asymptomatic bacteriuria, because you have risk of pyelonephritis or preterm delivery and stillbirths. So we should do test of cure in pregnant women, not in the other type of patients. And this is a brief summary in these guidelines from regarding catheter-associated asymptomatic bacteriuria and catheter-associated UTIs. And what is important? It's important to try to avoid the use of catheters. You know that it's important. It's one of the most common healthcare-associated infections worldwide. And it's important to try to avoid the use of catheters whenever it's possible. And one of the most important rules is not use just for incontinence, of course, and as long as it's needed. Not just leave the catheter in place for more than 30 days or if it's not needed. And this is the definition of catheter-associated urinary tract infections, not asymptomatic bacteriuria. In patients with a catheter, intermittent catheterization or suprapubic, if the patient has signal symptoms, we will see now in a minute what type of signs or symptoms you can have in a patient that is from a nursing home, that is not able to communicate because has dementia. But the breakpoint to consider UTI is 10 to the third colonies of one single species, of course. Or if the catheter has been removed in the last 48 hours, and the patient now he doesn't have any catheter in place, still is considered a catheter-associated urinary tract infection. There is no recommendation or coliforming unit for specimen collected by condom catheter still. We don't know what is the cutoff. But all the other forms of catheters, permanent catheters, intermittent catheters, or suprapubic is 10 to the third. And when we consider the patient probably bedridden with dementia, is not able to communicate, when this patient can have catheter-associated urinary tract infection, of course, new onset of worsening fever that you don't know the source is one possible. Rigors, chills, altered mental status, new altered mental status, of course. Malaise, lethargy, flat pain. Acute hematuria is not very specific. Pelvic discomfort. In those whose catheter has been removed, they have prolonged urgency, prolonged burning, frequent urination or suprapubic pain. And patients that are paraplegic, usually they have more spasticity. We have a patient here in UofL that is admitted every two or three times a month. Every time he is admitted, he has more spasticity, he has tachycardia. Of course, he always has positive blood cultures. We know him, but sometimes he has more spasticity, and that's it. It's the only signs that he has to reflect that he has an infection. Unexplained fall in the blood pressure, of course, the patient is becoming septic. You can suspect that it's from the catheter. Now this is catheter-associated asymptomatic bacteriuria. Again, patient with indwelling catheter, suprapubic or intermittent, is defined by the presence of 10 to the fifth, in this case, of more than one bacterial species in a single catheter urine specimen. In a patient, of course, without symptoms, a patient that doesn't have symptoms, and the breakpoint is 10 to the fifth. And if the patient has a condom catheter, to define asymptomatic bacteriuria, has to be a specimen drawn from a freshly applied condom. And the breakpoint is 10 to the fifth. And in this case, all these patients have leukocytes in urea analysis, so the presence, absence, or degree of pyuria should not be used to differentiate between asymptomatic bacteriuria or UTI. So you should not take into account the number of leukocytes that you have in urine analysis to define is you have to ask the patient if he has symptoms or not, or any of the signs that we saw before. Again, the presence of absence or full smelling or cloudy urine alone is not used to differentiate between asymptomatic bacteriuria or UTI, or as indication for urine culture or antibiotic therapy. And we see this all the time, not only here in private hospital, is worldwide, not only here. We are treating a lot for asymptomatic bacteria in patients with long-term catheters. And of course, the collateral damage is really important. what are the alternatives of injury ureteral catheterization? Of course, condom use, that we can see more and more patients with condoms catheterization. Of course, you have to have minimal residual volume, and the patient doesn't have to have cognitive impairment, no dementia, or have to be very alert and cooperative. Of course, the intermittent catheterization, and this is especially important for patients with spinal cord injuries. The intermittent catheterization has been widely proved that can help to prevent infection in patients with spinal cord injury. There is a lot of literature regarding that. Or the suprapubic catheterization is one option. But this is more complicated because you need kind of minimal procedure, but still you have to be done by surgeon. You need like a couple of weeks until you have the tract, the sinus tract, and it's difficult to change the catheter. So what are the strategies to prevent catheter-associated asymptomatic bacteria and catheter-associated UTIs? You can see all the no's, the no. No catheter irrigation, of course, with antibiotics, this is useless. No antibiotics in the drainage bag, it has been demonstrated that it's actually increased resistance, collateral damage, and increased the risk of infection. No antibiotics prophylactically, IV or oral. No methenamine salts, no cranberry products in neurogenic bladders, and no enhanced daily neonatal care. The only two measures that prove that are very effective to prevent infection in patients with catheters is recommendation A2, it has to be a closed system, even for short-term, long-term, or suprapubic catheters. The use of closed system has been decreased. The incident for the last year this is one of the measures that has been widely proved. And there is some evidence, but it's B2. It means that it's not from randomized controlled trials. The antimicrobial coated catheters in short terms, less than 30 days, can be useful, but still, it's not a recommendation A to use it. And when we have to change the catheter, I was doing a review, and data are insufficient to make a recommendation as to whether routine catheter exchange, yeah, traditionally has been changed monthly, in patients with functional long-term enduring urethral or suprapubic catheter, reduce the risk of asymptomatic bacteriuria UTI. Traditionally, it has been changed every month in the nursing home, but there's no evidence if the catheter is working, is needed, and doesn't have any type of complication. There's no time frame to change it, unless the patient, of course, has clots or any local complication of the catheter that you cannot use it anymore. But there is no time to change it, time frame. Of course, if you are suspecting a catheter-associated urinary tract infection, a urine culture should be obtained prior to antibiotics therapy. This is A3. And of course, if the catheter is still indicated, the patient has an obstruction that cannot be pelvic mass or prostatic problems, severe prostatic hyperplasia, and has been in place for more than 2 weeks, of course, it should be replaced, and this is recommendation A1. Or, if feasible, you can use intermittent catheterization, but usually in this case, it's replaced. and of course, the catheter should be taken from the freshly placed catheter before starting antibiotics. So you have to change the catheter and then take the culture with the new catheter. This is the way to do it. And of course, there is no indication to keep the catheter in place. It can be taken out and avoided midstream urine specimen should be obtained. This is the way if you no longer need the catheter. Of course, the length of therapy for catheter-associated urinary tract infection is 7 days if you have prompt resolution of symptoms, and 10-14 days if you have delayed response, and this is A3, regardless of whether it remains the catheter in place or not. And there is some trials that you can use 5 days of levofloxacin. Levofloxacin, the half-life of the levofloxacin is really prolonged, so usually what you can use 7 days with ciprofloxacin, you can use 5 days with levofloxacin. Now the last topic, asymptomatic bacteriuria. And there is a guideline from 2005. What is the definition of asymptomatic bacteriuria? For asymptomatic women, 2 consecutive voided urine specimens with isolation of the same bacterial strain in quantity counts of more than 10 to the fifth, but you need 2 consecutive void specimens. And this is because women in the 30s, 40s, usually they have intermittent bacteriuria. And it doesn't mean that they have really a true bacteriuria. So you need to have 2 samples. But in clinical practice, usually the diagnosis is made with just 1. It's not common to get 2. But according to the guidelines, and it's a recommendation B2, should be 2 samples with more than 10 to the fifth with the same type of bacteria. In men, with 10 to the fifth also, a single clean touch voided urine with 1 bacterial species isolated in a quantity count of more than 10 to the fifth. In this case, we don't need 2, according to the guidelines, with 1 is enough because it's not common to have intermittent bacteria in men. And if you have a single catheterized urine specimen with 1 bacterial species isolated in a quantitative count more than 10 to the second, in this case, either for women or for men, you have diagnosis of asymptomatic bacteriuria. This is because if you are taking the sample with a catheter, you are supposed to need less colony count to make the diagnosis. So with 10 to the second is enough. Again, the presence of leukocytes in the urine analysis can be infectious or non-infectious. You can have glomerulonephritis or renal stones, and it's not sufficient to diagnose bacteriuria and does not differentiate symptomatic from asymptomatic urinary tract infection. So you can see that the leukocytes in regarding urinary tract infection is very sensitive but not specific enough to make decisions. And of course, it's not an indication for antimicrobial treatment. And what are the indications to treat asymptomatic bacteriuria? Of course, all the pregnant women should be screening for bacteriuria. At least 1, usually is recommended from 12 to 16 weeks in early pregnancy. And they should be treated if the results are positive. And this is recommendation A1. You have more incidence in pregnant women, like we said before, with pyelonephritis, premature delivery, low birth weight. And the treatment usually is for 3 to 7 days. This is recommendation A3. In this case, we need test of cure. Remember that we have to do then, after we finish treatment, to do monthly urine culture to be sure that the patient is no longer bacteriuric. We should do a screen for and treatment of asymptomatic bacteriuria before transurethral resection of the prostate. And this is again recommendation A1. And this is why, because all the urological procedures, when you have mucosal bleeding, you have risk for bacteriemia and seeding. This is why you have to detect and treat. The recommendation A1 is for transurethral resection of the prostate, but actually all the urological procedures, you should test before the procedure and treat. Before or immediately before. And you need test of cure, of course, before the procedure. If you have a patient that you decide to screen and is positive and you decide to treat it, antimicrobial therapy should not be continued after the procedure unless the patient has an indwelling catheter in place. And for how many days after the procedure you will treat with the catheter in place? It's, again, it's not known, 24, 48, depends on the cause of destruction, and it's very variable. But they couldn't find for how long you treat. So the only two indications to treat asymptomatic bacteria is pregnant woman and urological procedures. And of course, we don't have to treat asymptomatic bacteria in premenopausal non-pregnant women, diabetics, older patients living in the community, elderly, patients that are coming from a nursing home, that we know that the patient is colonized, but it's asymptomatic. Person with spinal cord injury, these patients, you know that with long-term catheterization, that is more than 30 days, almost 100% of the patient will have bacteriuria. So all the patients with spinal cord injury, they go intermittent catheterization, has long-term catheters, are gonna be colonized. But if they have, they don't have symptoms, we should not treat it. And catheterized patient while the catheter remains in situ, we should not treat. Like I said before, 100% of the patients with long-term catheters will have asymptomatic bacteriuria. And the way to differentiate asymptomatic bacteriuria is just seeing the patient and ask the patient if he has symptoms or not, or in the case the patient cannot communicate, to see some indirect signs of infection like low blood pressure, increased white blood cells, fever. Of course, fever in a patient in the hospital, you can have 20 reasons to have fever. But you can make a case and take a decision to treat if you have fever with no clear source and you have urine culture that is positive with a correct technique to take the culture to go ahead and treat. And that's it.